I don't wanna grow up, I'm a curious kid. The world has 100 questions I can play with. So I'll open my arms and eyes and wonder every day till the day I die. No one really knows why gravity exists. Naming something doesn't mean that we get it. So I'll live each day with wonder. See the universe through a brand new set of eyes.
I'm so glad to be here. It's due to Ken Tro and to Splunk that you're comfortable right now and that Wonderfest is able to bring you a great scientist, a great public speaker. All right, now, it is my privilege to introduce Dr. Ken Wharton. He's professor of physics and astronomy at San José State University. He received his bachelor's degree in physics from Stanford and his PhD in physics from UCLA. Dr. Wharton joined San José State in 2001, originally as an experimental physicist, as a laser physicist. Now he participates in perhaps the grandest challenge of modern physics, that is to reconcile the two great physics theories of quantum mechanics and general relativity. Fans of TV's Big Bang Theory, especially, will realize what an impressive transformation Ken has undergone. He was once experimentalist Leonard Hofstadter, and now he is theorist Sheldon Cooper. Bazinga! Beyond Professor Wharton's numerous academic papers, he has also written scientifically accurate science fiction. Perhaps best known of his novels is Divine Intervention. Published in 2001 by ACE, Divine Intervention won huge recognition, the special citation for the Philip K. Dick Award. That title again is Divine Intervention by, and please welcome, Professor Ken Wharton.
Thank you, Tucker, and thank you to Wonderfest for hosting this, and thank you to Ken and Splunk for organizing all this. I was going to talk about this, but instead, after that introduction, I think I'm going to switch to my fun with flags talk. Big Bang Theory joke. Okay, so I first gave this talk at another Wonderfest event to the Bay Area skeptics and sort of designed this talk around talking to a skeptical audience. And that's kind of what we're going to start with here. We're going to start with when and why we should be skeptical. And if you see something magic, how should you respond? Should we just just gape and in amazement and just have that be that, or are we going to actually try instead, hopefully, to use a little skepticism, to use really the scientific method, or scientific skepticism, I'll call it, to analyze miraculous seeming events. And maybe instead of starting about how to be skeptical, let's talk about things you want to make sure. Come on in, please. We're just starting here. Everyone's braving the rain, coming out here. Thank you. Okay, so if we don't want to be a skeptic, then you might just go with your gut. You might just trust your instincts. If somebody offers you an explanation, you might say, "Oh, that's good enough for me." And especially if it's a convenient explanation or a comforting explanation that you like, you might just stick with it. And if maybe another explanation comes along, I'm happy with the first one. You might just dismiss alternate explanations without really considering them because you found one you're happy with. So that's how not to be a skeptic. So instead, as a physicist, nature is performing magic tricks, and nature is doing things, and we want to explain magic. We want to say, well, how did that work? So I don't know. Let's do a very simple magic trick. You, sir, here in the plaid here. I'm going to pick a card. Go ahead and think of a card. Don't even tell me what it is. Just any card at all.
I don't care what it is.
Not yet. Just hang on to it in your mind. Okay, now, if I was a good magician here, I would be planting some patter here of how this magic trick is going to work. So I've put a card here, and maybe I'll say that he's going to say the card. And actually, go ahead and tell me what your card is here.
You want to know?
The King of Hearts. Okay, the King of Hearts. So maybe I'll say, okay, I'm going to magically have that King of Hearts fly out of the deck and be the card that I selected here in the front. So maybe just magically action at a distance. Or maybe I would tell you, before I picked the card, I looked into the future and I saw what he was going to say, and therefore I knew which card to pick out. Or I might tell you, that you didn't really have free choice. I controlled what you chose, and you actually had no freedom at all. So a magician probably wouldn't tell you all of these things, would tell you one of them, because he wants you to pick one reasonable sounding explanation. And then when you reveal it here, oh, okay. So amazing. Now, of course, being good skeptics, all of us here, we're not going to fall for these first offered explanations here, and all of those should seem very suspicious to you. So I don't know, what would be a more realistic explanation for how this trick was done? Yeah, that's my father-in-law. Yeah. So yes, there was a correlation, right, between what he said and what was over here. And a pretty good guess was there was a common cause that explained this correlation between these two different events. And that's when there's not direct causation, as there clearly wasn't in this case, you should definitely always look for a common cause. That's a good first principle. Okay, so now, if somebody had done this trick and you weren't really sure how it was done, you would probably want to do some systematic reproduction, see if I could do it again. You'd want to look in all the black boxes, make sure, you know, there's nothing funny going on in this deck of cards. Take control of the parameters. Maybe you would pick a card. James Randi does this when he has claimed psychics who can do a magic trick. He controls the parameters and prevents them from doing anything secret. And of course, maybe it's so obvious I don't even have to mention, but you kind of assume that there was some underlying reality here all along. It didn't just come into existence magically. You assume that there was something under the card there. And even though that may seem so obvious, why do I bother mentioning it? That we're going to come back to this very important point. It's kind of assumed that there's some underlying reality to explain in the first place. And then over your life, you've probably developed very useful shortcuts. If you have a hypothesis for an explanation of a trick, of a magic trick, that violates one of your core physical intuitions, like the ones I offered you at the beginning, you're probably going to be ultra critical of them. And namely, what I have here, those three I mentioned: action at a distance, no control of the past or messages from the future, and I can't control, there's no fine control of a free choice that you think you can make freely. So if there's an account of a magic trick that violates one of these core physical intuitions, we should all be very suspicious. And they're so useful, we don't even bother testing them. Basically, if there's some explanation of something that uses one of these, we usually don't even bother testing them. But we're going to see some trouble with these in a minute, because now we're going to look at the weirdest magic tricks that nature has to throw at us. And that's, you know, what physicists are doing. We're trying to explain the events we see in nature here. Especially, and I'm not going to talk about certain kinds of experiments like astrophysics, where you can't actually get out there and mess around with the star and see what's going on. I'm mainly going to be focused on lab-based phenomena, you know, things you can do in the lab. Although it's certainly true that you can use the skeptical method in astrophysics as well. And it's been extremely successful, right? The scientific method has guided us to very, very predictive explanations and physical principles that have helped us build all sorts of fantastic devices. But there have been some core intuitions under threat from physics as well. And right really from the beginning, from Newton, one of our core intuitions in particular was threatened. And here I'm talking about Newton's theory of gravity. Basically, Newton just postulated that there's this magical action at a distance, gravity between, you know, the sun and the Earth and the Moon, apples and the Earth. So he's basically postulating exactly what should violate one of our core intuitions. And here are some harsh words in response to this. This is just 6 years after he published his theory of gravity. That one body may act upon another at a distance through a vacuum without the mediation of anything else by and through which their action and force may be conveyed from one to the other is to me so great an absurdity that I believe no man who has in philosophical matters a competent faculty of thinking can ever fall into it. So this is a pretty harsh retort. Any ideas who said this? Trump. Not Trump, no. not Bacon, yeah. Leibniz is a great guess. He and Newton had a lot of things, yes. No. Oh wait, who said that? Who said that in the back? Newton. Newton himself said this. he recognized that this was nuts. This idea that the moon is going to magically pull on the Earth without anything in between was action at a distance. It violated his core physical intuition. And so even though it was extremely successful, he figured this was probably not the end of the story. Now, it would be a long time, more than 200 years, before that next part of the story would get filled in. But he wisely copped out. He says, I have not as yet been able to deduce from phenomena the reason for these properties of gravity, and they do not feign hypotheses. He's not going to BS his way into explaining how this works. He doesn't know. Okay, so we have some action and distance, and I mentioned it was over 200 years before we were able to fill in the gap and explain how the gravity is getting from one thing to the other. And that was Einstein that did that in his theory of general relativity. He basically fixed Newtonian gravity. It's no longer an action and distance theory, but rather the gravity is carried by space-time itself. Just recently, they've actually measured gravitational waves traveling through space-time. So Newton was right. It was a long time before we got rid of the action and distance. And as it turned out, it didn't stay away for all that long. Because very shortly after, well, this is an action at distance, but this is another threat to the scientific skepticism, is Heisenberg, at the dawn of quantum theory, comes up with this uncertainty principle. And basically saying, there's some black boxes we can't even open. We can't even get in to see what's going on down there. And the key example I want to talk about is that a particle can't have both a well-defined position and a velocity. And he came up with all sorts of good arguments and seemingly ironclad logic and evidence that there is no, either you can't know both the particle's position and velocity, or as it's interpreted today, there is no well-defined position and velocity of a particle at the same time. You can measure the position, you can measure the velocity, but you can't measure both. Over these years in the late 20s, early 30s, quantum mechanics, what we're mainly going to be talking about here, is really formulated. Von Neumann in 1932 kind of wrote up what people knew about quantum mechanics and noted that there has to be this weird collapse of probability whenever you make a measurement. Whenever you make a measurement, he noted that in order for quantum theory to work, basically what started out as a mess of probabilities has to turn into something actual. And in the math, he said that this mathematical object that has all these probabilities has to change. It has to suddenly collapse into a bunch of possibilities to one something more precise. And so this also is a threat against our wanting to look and see how magic is done, because the very act of looking, if you believe that this collapse is real, the very act of looking is changing what's there. And so if you can't even know what was there before you look, because the moment you look, you've changed it, this procedure of trying to explore our universe with scientific method is under attack. And we're going to come back to this question, is the probability real? I mean, lots of times you don't know something, there's a probability, and you're playing cards, and then you turn up a card, and then the probabilities collapse to a particular value, right? That certainly is not weird, right? That's just, you're updating your knowledge. And so we're going to come back to this question, is this probability collapse weird or not? And it's even not all that clear at this point. Okay, but our main topic of the day here is entanglement. And that was just a few years later where entanglement really got nailed down exactly started to get nailed down of what was so weird about it in 1935. And just to preface this, another famous quantum physicist, Schrodinger, his cat's probably more famous than he is, but he makes this quote, measurements on separated systems cannot directly influence each other. That would be magic. So he's actually using the magic word here, magic. And he's saying there shouldn't be action at a distance. What you do over here shouldn't influence directly what you do over there. And in principle, over here and over there could be very, very far apart. And there might be nothing in between. Okay, so what he was referring to here was a paper. It was written by Podolsky, but Einstein got the first author. The EPR paper, Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen, and they demonstrated that any literal reading of this mathematics they've been developing for the last 8 years has action and distance in it. The action and distance that Einstein got rid of in gravity is back, and Einstein himself was the one who kind of showed how this worked. So the way I'm going to talk about these experiments is on something called a space-time diagram. So I always have time going up. So future events are at the top and past events are at the bottom. We're going to lay everything out as a big block. Something that's called the block universe. And in the past, we have a source of two correlated particles. And those particles, one of them goes in one direction and one of them goes in another. Now this is all the same particle, just at different times. It should be a continuous line, really. But imagine a particle is two particles are leaving, and then later they're further apart, and later they're further apart, and then they end up over here. Nothing's moving on this diagram, right? That would require an additional time, but I've represented time as a spatial axis, so there's no ordinary time left. Everything's frozen because I've translated ordinary time onto this spatial axis. Okay, now it's sort of canon that when you do experiments of this sort, you have people measuring the two particles, and it's just for historical reasons, these two people are Alice and Bob. So Alice measures one particle and Bob measures the other. So here we have Alice and Bob, and they're going to make measurements on these particles, and they're correlated. And basically this was Einstein's argument. If Alice measures position of her particle, it collapses into a particular position, because that's what she measured, but it's correlated with Bob's particle. So she can now calculate the position of Bob's particle. And sure enough, according to the rules of quantum mechanics, Bob's particle also collapses into a well-defined position. Now, maybe it was there all along, maybe it wasn't, but this was the key point they made. They said, but Alice doesn't have to measure position. She might make a different measurement. She might measure velocity instead. And now, something different would happen to her particle. It wouldn't collapse to a well-defined position. It can't have a well-defined position and velocity. It collapses to a well-defined velocity. But now, since it's correlated with Bob's particle is also collapsing into a well-defined velocity. And so, sure enough, that's what happens over on Bob's side. He has a well-defined velocity particle. But the key point is that no particle can have a well-defined position and velocity, according to the uncertainty principle. So if you think Bob over here might have a well-defined velocity, and he might have a well-defined position, depending on what Alice does over here, what choice she makes to how she measures it is going to change whether it collapses one way or the other, and it can't have both because of the uncertainty principle. Now you're talking about action at a distance. So this was the argument, that somehow Alice's choice of what to measure is seemingly, not a signal, but seemingly somehow somehow causing something to happen over on Bob's side. And when I use this word entanglement, that's what I'm talking about. When you have two particles in quantum theory that are correlated in this way, or in a more subtle way, as we'll talk about, that's what entanglement is. Entanglement is this weird correlation between particles that seems to imply there's some weird action at distance going on. And this is a magic trick that nature's doing, and we want to understand what's going on. And it's violating one of our core intuitions, right? This action at a distance. We don't like that. In principle, Alice and Bob can be very far apart, light years apart. Okay, so let's go through our skeptical method that we use to analyze magic and see where it leads us. Certainly, we should be ultra critical of anything that violates action at a distance, and we should consider alternate hypotheses, right? Not the first idea that pops into your head. Now, what about this card example? This card example that we did. what was the explanation of the correlation between Ron's choice and this card? It was a common cause, right? It was a common cause in the past. Why not look for a common cause here? We have correlations between these two particles. Let's look for a common cause. So here's an example. We have two cards here, a red card and a black card. And I'm going to mix them up behind my back. And then I'm going to separate them out. Separate them out, one over here and one over here. This could be very, very far away. Now, right now, the state of the cards, you don't know which one's red and which one's black. There's a 50-50 chance one's red and one's black, and one's black and one's red. But as soon as over here, as soon as, say, Alice looks and see the red card is over here, you immediately now know that the black card is over there. Now, clearly, there was no action at distance going on here, right? The communication of was just in your head. You updated your state of knowledge, and now you know something that's happening over there. But there's no action at distance in this case. And so Einstein imagined that there should also be no action at distance in this case. In this case, Einstein imagined that these correlations might have some hidden instructions. The example of a hidden instruction would be, is it red or black? And that would be hidden from the experimenter. And then you have some real thing that Alice is measuring, maybe. Maybe some other real thing is really over here. They're correlated, like these two cards are real. They were correlated because of their common past. And then what quantum probabilities are aren't real. They're just in your head, just like the probabilities of these cards were in your head. And those probabilities can collapse, no problem, right? You can it's called Bayesian updating. You update your probability, and now you know something you didn't know before. When you make a measurement, you update your probabilities. If you don't, when you learn new things, if you don't update your state of mind, you're doing it wrong. Anytime you learn something new, update. It's a good principle. So this was Einstein's favorite resolution, that this probability collapse wasn't weird, he argued. It's just ordinary updating of knowledge, like these cards. And there's something you don't know, hidden instructions that you're learning about when you make your measurement, and then you update this. So this was Einstein's favored argument. He said quantum theory was not complete. There's something hidden instructions hiding in the past, like one card has to be red and one card has to be black. That was not the view propounded by Niels Bohr and other founders of quantum mechanics. They had this alternative view that's sometimes known as the Copenhagen interpretation. And basically, the argument is, look, it's a successful mathematical framework. It makes all the right predictions. Why complicate matters by throwing in these new hidden pieces? We got a perfectly good theory. Just not worry about there's some missing piece. It's perfectly good. It's working well. And the math says, by the way, there is no reality on the left, and there is no reality on the right. There's just one giant quantum thing. In fact, according to the math, it doesn't even fit in three dimensions or four dimensions with time. It's a six-dimensional structure. So it can't fit in space-time. It can't be anywhere. It's bigger than space-time. We think this is weird, but you know, we're just experiencing large things. We don't have experience on these scales, and so let's not worry that this is crazy. Let's just go with it. And then there's a lot of talk and words trying to say, oh, this isn't so bad. Basically, that's the idea. There's this giant six-dimensional structure. It's not anywhere, right? Because we only live in three dimensions. And then they measure something. It suddenly now there's reality. There is a reality over here when she looks, and the reality over there when Bob looks. And this was basically what Bohr said. We don't really need a reality in space and time. And that's probably all right for these various confusing reasons. OK, now we talked about how not to be a skeptic. Anyone spot any poor reasoning on this side here? Well, what's Bohr doing here? He's copping out. He's saying, we got an explanation. Let's just stop. Let's not look further. He's actually throwing out one of our core physical intuitions that there's some reality in space and time to find out what it is, and he's like, no, we don't need that. And people did not take Einstein's argument seriously. So you might think that you have this well-reasoned argument that there's a common cause that seems reasonable based in cards, and then you have Bohr's arguments to the extent that you can make sense of them. And what side did physicists tend to come down at? Well, here's a historical summary by a guy we'll talk about in a minute, John Bell. He says, for me, it's so reasonable to assume that the particles, the photons in those experiments, carry with them programs which have been correlated in advance, telling them how to behave. This is so rational that I think when Einstein saw that and the others refused to see it, he was the rational man. I feel that Einstein's intellectual superiority over Bohr in this instance was enormous, a vast gulf between the man who saw clearly what was needed and the obscurantist, referring to how obscure it was to make sense. So this is basically saying Einstein had the better arguments. And yet, the physicists at the time kind of thought Einstein had lost. They said, no, Bohr won these debates. We're not going to go back and revisit this. And basically, people stopped worrying about hidden instructions. They were generally abandoned, except by Einstein and a few others. And this, I think, is a real black eye to the physicists at the time, in that they weren't really being good skeptics. They had found this theory, and already they were starting to get into the shut up and calculate mode, where they didn't ask these questions. Or by World War II, it had really taken over, and it was really frowned if you would ask deep questions about quantum mechanics. And that's stayed for a long time. It's only really in the last decade or two that finally quantum foundations is becoming an acceptable topic for physicists to be wondering about what's going on down here. Okay. But that's not the end of the story, because Einstein's argument in 1935 was not as solid as it could have been, it turned out. And after Einstein died, John Bell discovered that hidden instructions, as reasonable, as wonderful as the arguments are, that there was probably a common cause correlating these things, hidden instructions simply don't work. And I'm going to try to walk you through the outline of this experiment. This famous experiment that John Bell essentially proposed and was done not long after, and has been done many times since. And basically, it's a special kind of correlated particles, a special entangled pair. And I remember we talked about how Alice had a choice of measurement. She could measure position or velocity. Well, here she has a choice, too. She has choice between measurement A and B. And Bob also has a choice. Measurement C or D. He has a choice on the other side. So both of them are choosing how are they going to measure this particle. And for this particular kind of entangled pair, it turns out they always get one of two outcomes. They either find one or two. It doesn't matter what they are. They're just two possible outcomes. Either one or two is going to happen. And each one is a 50-50 chance all the time. So you, no matter what measurement you make, A or B, you're going to get one half the time. You're going to get two half the time. This sounds kind of boring. But it's not boring, because even though each individual outcome is very boring, there can still be correlated, right? They could still both be one. Or they could always be opposite. Or they could always be the same. So even though the individual outcomes are boring and random, there's interesting patterns in the correlations between the two. And what Bell showed was that what quantum mechanics predicted for these particular measurements, if you're interested, I could tell you what they are, but it doesn't really matter, that most of the time, the outcomes were always opposite. In fact, if Alice chose A and Bob chose C, they're opposite 85% of the time. If Alice chose A and Bob chose D, again, if Alice chose B and Bob chose C, the only time that that's not the case is if Alice chooses B, their measurement choice B, and Bob chooses D, and then it's flipped. Then it's most of the time the outcomes are identical. And you could try to figure out how you, suppose you imagine you are one of these particles and your friend is another particle, and you can communicate at the beginning as much as you want. You can pass each other one-time secret pads, and you know what order you're going to say one and two in, and then you go off into separate rooms, and Alice asks you A or B, and Bob asks the other person C or D, and you can try to come up with some scheme that will give you these correlations. And I promise you, you will be able to come up with no such scheme. And basically, the problem is, suppose you wander into Alice's room, and she says B. Well, you don't know. You're just like, well, I don't know what's happening in the other room, C or D, so I don't know, should I try to get the opposite choice of Bob or the same choice of Bob? You don't know. And so you can try to come up with a scheme, but it turns out the best you can do, Bell proved that the best you can do is 75-25. You can't get to 85-15 as quantum theory predicts. And so basically, Bell shows that the hidden instructions fails for these particular experiments. They don't get you to what you actually see. And some people saw this as a dare, like, okay, let's do the experiment. This hadn't actually been done. Let's do the experiment and see, we can actually test. If it's hidden instructions, we'll only get 75-25, but if quantum theory is right, we'll get 85-15. So they have been doing the experiments. There are just three big new ones in the last year or two. And the quantum correlations, the 85-15, are the ones that match the experiments. And these new experiments are, I don't know if you see the titles here, these are called loophole-free Bell inequality violation using spins separated by 1.3 kilometers. So basically, they went to a campus and sent a beam of particles to building A and a beam of particles to building B, and there was over a kilometer in between, and they measured them basically simultaneously. And they did it in a way that not even a light speed signal between A and B would be fast enough to send a signal. So if there was action at a distance, or a super fast signal between them somehow that we don't know about, it would have to be faster than light. Okay, so that is really weird. Basically, this very good argument that Einstein gave in the 30s, that there's probably some hidden thing, some hidden instructions telling these particles what to do that we don't know about. The common cause argument seems to fail in this case. And it's been tested and tested and tested. And sure enough, the hidden instructions don't work. Okay, so let's survey what we've learned so far. So this quantum mathematics, the stuff in the equations, is either what there really is, this six-dimensional or much, much higher dimensional object, which is not living in space and time. It's weird. It's like the probabilities you had in your head before I turned the cards. Half red, half black. Where does that probability live? It doesn't live in space-time. So maybe that's what there really is. Or maybe Einstein was right. Maybe these things are states of knowledge and about things that live in space-time. If there's no reality in space-time, the whole skeptical method is pretty shot, right? That was kind of the assumption that went into solving these magic tricks, that there is some reality to explain. But if it's a state of knowledge about things, and we apply our core physical intuitions the way Einstein did, we come to the idea that there must be hidden instructions, there must be a common cause. But this is ruled out by these experiments. So that's not a path forward. We can't get hidden instructions to explain this. So then people say, well, maybe we should throw this part out. They're just states of knowledge, but they're not about things in space and time. Sometimes you hear this phrase, it from bit. It's all information all the way down. Or there's a group of people that call themselves cubists who say, you know, there doesn't have to be any reality. It's all knowledge, but it's not knowledge about anything. But in that case, there's no reality underlying it, and you're back to this problem there's no reality in space and time. So I call this the skeptic's conundrum. Basically, we have these magic tricks that nature's doing, these experiments, and we can't use our usual skeptical toolbox because either there's no reality in space time, or you run up against these weird 85-15 probabilities that can't be explained with common causes. Okay, so now we really need to take a step back. This is tough. This is looking like maybe there is magic in nature. But if, just to say we can't use the skeptical method is certainly too fast. I mean, what is the skeptical method? We talked about it at the beginning, right? It's a whole toolbox of ideas. And I want to separate that toolbox into just the general way you approach problems, and then these useful physical assumptions that we found very useful. So we want to trust experiment and reproduction, so we believe these experiments. We want to look in the black boxes and assume control of the parameters, unless, of course, it's quantum theory, in which case we can't look in the black boxes and we can't control the parameters because when we look, it seems to change them. So this is a problem. We don't just want to go with our gut instincts. And we don't want to throw out other, we want to really consider everything before we give up and be like the baboon at the beginning and just gape and say, ah, it's amazing, it's magic. Let's really try to come up with the right explanations. Okay, so then on top of that, we have our useful assumptions. So that's the general toolbox. And then we assume there is some underlying reality. And then we have these shortcut assumptions. Remember the three magic proposals? We have there's no action at a distance. We have there's no control of the past. And we have there's no fine control of your free choices. So we have these shortcut assumptions. We usually don't even worry about considering these. But we're at an impasse here. We have this conundrum. Maybe something's wrong with one of our physical assumptions. If we throw out reality, we throw out all of this. So maybe we don't want to be so hasty. Maybe one of these assumptions is wrong. We've already talked about action at distance being wrong. So maybe there really is action at distance. Maybe that's the lesson of these correlations. Maybe there is weird control of the past. We should consider that. We've got to consider all the possibilities. I'm not going to consider this third one here. Because if that fails, you can't do experiments. I mean, to do an experiment, what do? You go in the lab and you make free choices and see how that's correlated with the result. If you can't trust that your choices are uncorrelated with the hidden instructions in the object, you can't do science at all. So really, three is kind of necessary to really keep the scientific method. So we just have these really two to worry about. And so basically, going back to the previous thing, there is a way out of this conundrum. And the way out is relax one of our physical intuitions. Maybe we're wrong about no action at distance. Maybe we're wrong about one of our physical intuitions. And if we want realism, if we want something that's really there, that's as I see it, that's our only hope. So let's go through these two physical intuitions and see which one we might have reason to throw out. So we've been talking about action at distance. Of course, this is what Einstein got rid of, finally, after 200 years in gravity, and is what he was trying to avoid. And maybe it's there, maybe it's back. But Newton's intuitions did turn out to be right, right? There was actually no action at distance for gravity, and it was very useful to fill in the gap. We discovered general relativity. It's been useful. We should, you know, if we can remove it, maybe we should. It was useful once. And of course, as we've been talking about it, right? It's well known. People write these papers, say, it looks like action at a distance. And so the experiments address it. They separate Alice and Bob such that if there is action at a distance, it would have to be faster than light action at a distance. And that is really weird. I mean, especially to a physicist. Now, maybe it doesn't seem that weird to you, but if relativity is right, and we have lots of evidence to see it is, relativity tells us if you have Alice and Bob making measurements in Alice is over here at slightly earlier time, and Bob's over there at a later time, but so slightly later that any connection between them would have to go faster than light. That's basically what we're talking about here. And it's possible there could be an unblockable signal that we can't measure that works at all distances, that's faster than light, and by the way, doesn't allow you to signal. It could be. But even if all of those five things are true, if relativity is right, it turns out you can view these very same events from a different perspective, from a rocket ship or a frame moving near the speed of light. And if you do that, the very same events actually change order in time. So this has been tested. There's no absolute simultaneity in relativity. There's no fact of the matter of which of these events happens first. One perspective says A happens first. Another perspective says B happens first. And so if you really think that this is a plausible explanation of these weird 85-15 correlations, you also are going to end up with backward in time influence. Not just action at a distance, but if you really think this is what's happening, then that's also what's happening from a different perspective, and you have a backward in time signal. So this other option is suddenly rearing its head, right? No control of the past, no messages from the future. So let's be complete here and analyze that as well. So this is two question marks on this, because this is a deep intuition, right? We know about causality, and we know that that the past causes the future and not the other way around. But we got to be good skeptics here and consider all the possibilities. This is actually so counterintuitive that you don't find this in most of the papers. People sometimes in a footnote, oh yes, by the way, if the future caused the past, then this argument doesn't go through. But usually, more often than not, it's just so obvious people don't even mention it. And I mean, there's good reason. We have good instincts about time, right? I mean, we've been shaped by our experience, by millions of years of evolution, and probably everyone might, obviously, you know, there's a special now between the past and the future, right? Right? Obviously, time is flowing, or maybe we're flowing through time. There's some sort of flow through time. Everyone has this sensation of time flow. And the past and the future, of course, we know are essentially different. And there's this built-in direction in time. And so these are our deep assumptions we know about time. Except that as we're discovering more and more about physics, we've discovered that we're actually wrong about all three of these. We have very, very good evidence that all three of these are totally wrong. So we have strong intuitions, but it turns out they're not very good intuitions. So this first one, special now separates the past and the future, that violates relativity. Remember I said there is no absolute simultaneity in relativity. So there is no magic line between the past and the future. If there was one, it would violate relativity by being a special line through space and time that's now. If you really think about it, now is no different from here. I mean, everywhere you ever go, and you know, there you are, and every when you've ever experienced, it seemed like now, right? This seems like now, and this seems like now, and this seems like now. So they're not, now is not a special thing. Now you can say now is special right now, but that's like saying here is special right here. So there's, and apart from the logic, it's physics has taught us that there is no special now. Okay, what about time flowing? Well, I already talked about this briefly. Remember on the block universe diagram, I said time is going up. So we're going to put all the events on the diagram, all those Alice and Bob diagrams. There was nothing, no motion on those diagrams, no flow. It's very intuitive to us to picture time as a spatial axis. In fact, in English language, most of the metaphors have the future in front of you, which is kind of weird because the future is not physically in front of you, but you can have, you know, the deadline approaching, right? It's coming toward you. but these are analogies. These are metaphors. These are metaphors we use. And if you really break down what you mean by that, what you mean is you're taking part of time and representing it as a spatial axis, right? But there's motion. And for there to be motion, there has to be change. And for there to be change, you need to keep a part of ordinary time ticking in the back of your head. So really, this whole metaphor of time flowing is shoddy. It's five-dimensional nonsense because you need two time dimensions. You need the spatial dimension to represent time, and then you need a time dimension for things to change and flow through that time dimension. And maybe we live in a five-dimensional universe, but there's not a lot of physics support for that. Time doesn't flow. It does not flow. Okay, what about this one? Clearly the past and future are different, right? Well, a big surprise in modern physics has been that's actually, the closer we look, that's not true. There's this deep time symmetry to all these processes. Now, the probably the most time asymmetric thing you learn about in physics early on is entropy, the idea that entropy always increases, disorder always increases. A classic example is you start with a bunch of air molecules in one corner of the room, and you wait, and they spread out, but they never go back the other way. And you say, ah, this is evidence the past and the future are essentially different. But when we're talking about microscopic phenomena here, we're talking about these tiny quantum phenomena. And if you just look at any two particles bouncing off each other, take a video of that, and play it in reverse, you actually can't tell. All the physics is the same, whether the two particles are bouncing one way or the other way. So where does this asymmetry come from? The answer is these experiments put it in by hand, or these thought experiments, or actual experiments, by starting with initial order. If you start with initial order, and you say, what happens next? You run physics forward, it becomes disordered. Anyone know what happens if you start with this and run the laws of physics backward? Say it becomes disordered, yeah. So you're putting in the asymmetry, not in the laws of physics. There's essentially, well, to be precise, there's no CPT asymmetry in the laws of physics. But essentially, there's no time asymmetry in the laws of physics. But there certainly can be time asymmetric boundary constraints. Like the Big Bang was very ordered. So we have this entropic arrow. We have this increasing disorder away from the Big Bang. But that's not saying there's an asymmetry in the laws of physics. That'd be like standing near a glacier and feeling a temperature gradient. The glacier's over here, it's colder over here, it's hotter over here. And you say, oh, space is asymmetric. No, right? It's just you have a constraint over here that puts a gradient there that makes it colder here and hotter here. The same thing here. If you have a special condition of the Big Bang, that doesn't put an asymmetry in the laws of physics. What we're talking about here is small scales. We're talking about this kind of scale. And our instincts about the difference between the past and the future are dead wrong on those scales. All of these phenomena we're talking about are fully time symmetric. So we have reason to doubt our intuitions about time. Okay, but, you say, okay, well, I might buy that there's no now. Maybe. I might buy there's no flow of time. I might buy that physics is time symmetric. But surely, you think, the deepest instinct of all is that explanations of events always lie in the past, right? Every time you found a good explanation of these cards here, the explanation was in the past. We discussed the King of Hearts on the train, and that was a past explanation of this future correlation. There's some reason to doubt this as well in physics, and it turns out that there's two ways to explain things in physics, and they actually kind of compete with each other. One has been named the Newtonian schema, which I like to think of the universe as a big computer. Basically, the idea is you take an initial state, the input to the computer, and you plug into the universe, and the universe, chug, 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 it solves some dynamical laws, force equals mass times acceleration, et cetera, and it spits out the output. That's the future. And that's one way to solve physics. And probably anyone who took physics in high school or college, this is the way you explained what happened by the initial conditions and the laws. But as you get further in physics, you discover there's this entirely other elegant way to think about it. It's called the Lagrangian schema. And instead of solving it sort of one time slice at a time, you solve these problems all at once. You actually put in initial conditions and final conditions, and then you self-consistently calculate what happens in the middle. The most commonly encountered version of this is something called Fermat's principle of least time. The path that light takes from a point A at the beginning to a point B at the end is the path that takes the least amount of time for the ray of light to get there. And you solve it all at once. You don't solve it one time step at a time. You look at the whole trajectory. And if you say, well, general relativity, which way does it work? The most sophisticated version of it that has the richest physics is on the Lagrangian schema side. And particle physics, that's over on that side too. The most sophisticated version of particle physics, the standard model of particle physics, is not an equation of motion. It's a Lagrangian that you solve all at once. And so it turns out that we do have a way to explain things in physics that doesn't rely just on initial conditions, the way this one does, but actually sometimes, in the math anyway, can rely on the final condition as well. So even though many physicists still picture the universe kind of working like a computer, there is some evidence that it doesn't have to be that way. And maybe this intuition we have that the past is causing everything. In this case, maybe that's not true. Maybe the future is just as important, at least maybe on small scales. Okay, so could this explain entanglement? Absolutely. This is how it would work. Well, in the Newtonian schema, what you want to do is you have the initial state evolving somehow in time and ready for all possible future measurements. So if you take the Newtonian schema, you can say, well, I don't know what the future settings are, so I need a big structure to cover all the possibilities. What if Alice chooses A or Bob chooses D? What if Alice chooses B, Bob chooses C? That's why you need such a big structure. The more possibilities there are, the more particles, the bigger the dimensionality of the structure. It's not just six. It goes three times the number of particles. Two particles at six. If you do an experiment with three particles, it's nine dimensions. It gets huge. Okay, but that's the Newtonian approach. What about Lagrangian approach? Lagrangian approach, remember, you start with the initial state, and there's a final condition as well. So if you look at it all at once, you're not thinking about it sequentially. You're just looking at the whole block all at once, and you're going to solve for the middle. We actually know that in the future, Alice will choose one thing. We don't know what it is. But if you could look into the future, maybe she chooses B. If you could look in the future, maybe Bob chooses D. Or maybe the experiment's already happened. You already know that Alice chose B and Bob chose D. And you're going back and you want to know what happened in the middle. So you solve it. You solve it all consistently all at once. When you do this Lagrangian technique, you use the past constraint, but you also use the future constraint as well. And in this case, we have particle here, it's all one kind of V-like system in space-time. And you don't need action at distance. You don't need anything here, right? You just can solve for what's going on here. There's a continuum between these two particles if you think in space-time. You think at instants, they're separated. But if you think of all space and time together, the way Einstein taught us to do, it's actually all connected. And then you say, well, can you explain these crazy correlations? And yes, it's trivial, because in this case, we don't need these correlations, because for this problem, Alice chooses B and Bob chooses D. We only need to get those, and that's trivial. Anyone could arrange with their friend to walk into the room and make sure that you always give 85% of the time identical outcome or answers, and 15% of the time different ones. That's easy to do. If you don't have to worry about these other possibilities, this is actually trivial. Now, you still have hidden parameters, but the key is that all these arguments assume they're hidden instructions. These aren't instructions. Right? Instructions are the Newtonian schema kind of thing, where the system evolves with some laws, and there are instructions telling the future what to do. In this Lagrangian perspective, they're not instructions. They're there. There's something here that we don't know, something that when you measure it, you can learn about and update your probabilities. But they're not just blind instructions that don't know about the future. I mean, really, physics has given up a lot of anthropocentric assumptions, right? We've assumed that we're in the middle of the universe, and we've discovered that that's not true. And on and on. We've basically discovered that all of these anthropocentric ideas that were important don't turn out to be true. But there's another anthropomorphism of nature that we do. And so we say, I don't know the future. So, dang it, this system better not know the future either. These particles better not be smarter than I am. They better not be ready for a particular kind of measurement, because I don't know it, and they better not know it either. Maybe that's one last anthropomorphic idea we have about particles, and maybe it needs to go. Maybe just because we don't know the future doesn't mean the future's not there, as the future's not real, waiting to happen. Something will happen tomorrow. I don't know what it is, but it's something will happen tomorrow, and maybe that's important. And this matches Einstein's resolution. Now the probabilities are things you don't know, that you find out about when you measure them, and you get around all these 85-15 problems using this. So I don't know if this is the solution or not, but definitely what I can say about what I think applying the skeptical method to entanglement tells us is certainly just because they're weird doesn't mean we should be like the baboon and gape. We should have no reason to give up on reality and say there's nothing there until we look. I think that's shoddy nonsense. something counterintuitive is going on in these experiments and quantum experiments in general. So one of our intuitions is wrong. The question is which one? Is it reaction at distance, or is it no control of the past, or is it reality itself? Which intuition is wrong? But the problem is, at that point, physicists often say, well, my intuition is that my intuition about action at a distance is probably wrong, and my intuition is that my intuition about causality is probably right. But that's just another intuition, right? The intuitions about the intuitions are just as likely to be wrong as the intuitions themselves. It's just basically saying which of our intuitions is strongest, which one's most deeply built in into my psyche, not which one's most likely right. You got to look at the evidence. You have to say, is our evidence that there's action at a distance plausible? There's really not very good evidence there's action at a distance. You say, is there evidence that my instincts about time are wrong? Yes, there is evidence that our instincts about time are wrong. There's really good evidence. So I say, that's what the evidence is arguably pointing to. It's arguably saying that what we need to explain entanglement is get rid of this Newtonian schema of the universe as a computer and solve these problems all at once. Sometimes these are called retrocausal explanations, or I like to use the phrase all at once explanations. This has been, I think, sadly neglected. And a lot, in general, I think if you accept it's magic, if you accept that these entanglement experiments are just, that's the way they are, you stop looking for deeper explanations. But scientific progress has required that we don't give up so easily. It's required that we keep looking, wanting to understand what's going on when we're not looking, and we should not give up on that quest. Thanks very much. Here's some light reading. You might if you read one thing, you might Google the phrase "the universe is not a computer." See my take on the all at once perspective, and some other things to search for as well. I believe there is a question. Good. How is that going to work?
If you don't mind just picking people.
Okay. Let's do it. Right here.
Okay. Let's say we could reduce ourselves to massless people. I get on one particle, you get on the other, we go flying apart at the speed of light. After a certain amount of time, how far apart would we view ourselves to be?
It's really hard to put yourself, the question was what happens if you're moving at the speed of light. It's really hard in relativity to put yourself at exactly the speed of light. There's not a coherent perspective of the universe if you're traveling at the speed of light. Fortunately, all matter can't actually quite get there. So you can talk about what happens if you're at 0.9999, a million nines at percent of the speed of light.
I guess my point is, if you're in the reference frame of the particles.
Okay, good.
Very, very fast.
Okay.
They may not view themselves to be very far apart after even a great amount of time.
Well, so
the actual distance from their perspective,
Okay.
They might be right next to each other.
So there are certain things that are frame dependent in relativity, where different perspectives get different numbers, different distances, different times. But there are certain invariants that everyone can agree on, and if you have two events in space-time that a signal would have to be faster than light to go between in one reference frame. Everyone agrees, all reference frame agree that that signal would have to be faster than light. There's no other perspective where a slower than light signal could do the job. So that's one invariant in relativity, is how fast would the signal have to be, faster than light or slower than light, and everyone can agree faster than light. So that doesn't solve the problem. All right.
Wow.
Okay, yes.
This is on that same thing.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. But there's some magic limit where they can't be so far apart?
No, you can also have a C and D that you could have a slower than light signal between, and everyone would agree that a slower than light signal could get from C to D. But those are different events. A and B are Alice and Bob measuring simultaneously on the other sides. Yeah.
It seems like there should be some relative spot where it would be
Well, the distance and the time, it turns out everyone can agree, it turns out, yes. Okay, you had a question right here, yes. Yeah.
Can you talk about the device or machine or equipment where you get these entangled particles and what that's like, and also are there like wild entangled particles?
Yes, there are wild entangled particles. It's all done with mirrors. Often it is done with light. You send a one photon of light over there and one photon of light over here, and you can make measurements with even something as simple as a pair of polarized sunglasses, a polarizer, and measure is the polarization on this axis or this axis, or you can turn the polarizer and measure is it this axis or this axis, and actually that. You can do this experiment with two photons and two polarizers. And the choice, remember I said Alice makes a choice of measurement A or B? Her choice is what angle does she put her polarizing sunglasses at? So she has a choice. So you can actually do this experiment with light. Now, whether these particles exist in nature, absolutely. Anytime you have a particle decay into two particles, that those two particles are entangled. Anytime you have anyone know about photon down conversion, you send one particle of light into a crystal that splits it into two, those two photons are entangled. Yeah, it happens. Let's do one in the back, all the way in the back here. Yes, yes.
I know this is not really revealed, but
okay. There's some really interesting research about the perception of time that I love reading about. I don't quite even understand at all about how you're looking at somebody's brain, you can actually figure out what decision they're going to make a split second before they even know, and all sorts of weird things. And it's not my field. I love reading about it, and there's some fun books about it, but that's about the limit of my knowledge, yeah. Even further back here, yes.
Hey, I'm her. Sorry for coming late, by the way. I just wanted to know. I heard you say that we don't live in like multiple dimensions, and so.
Well, we live in four, I would say.
So, like, are there any correlations between the idea of living in a multiverse with having multiple dimensions, or?
So you're touching on this one approach to quantum theory called the many worlds interpretation. And there's been some bad popular accounts of this, certainly, especially in movies. But basically what the many worlds interpretation is saying is it says, look, quantum mechanics says we live in this giant dimensional wave function, and we only see three dimensions. So that means we're only a small part of reality, and there's lots of other parts of reality out there that we're only a very small portion of. And so you could call these things other worlds. And that's basically saying that no, we don't live in three dimensions. We live in three times the number of particles in the universe, number of dimensions, plus one for time, which is treated differently than all the spatial ones. Because then you get to keep the Newtonian schema by keeping time, not messing with time. That's not my preferred approach. I want to first, before I give up on our lovely four dimensions that I know, I want to really have a good reason for giving up on it. Yeah. Yes. Oh well, that's really interesting. So can you test retrocausality? It all kind of these experiments you can argue are a test. If you believe in there's no action or distance and there's reality, then they're a test of retrocausality. But if you say, I believe there's no retrocausality and reality, then they're a test of no action and distance. And if you say there's no action and distance and there's no retrocausality, then this is a test that there's no reality. So it all kind of is the baggage you come in it with. I would love to come up with an experiment to do to tease these apart. But right now, you got to put assumptions in. And so whether you view these experiments as a test or not, actually most people view them, if you read the popular literature, as proof of spooky action at a distance is how it's often portrayed. But that's only if you assume no retrocausality, interestingly. Oh, we have a whole section over here. Yes, okay, good, good.
Yeah, related to your comments on the dimensionality aspect. I was wondering about what your take is related to light traveling through a vacuum of space, right? Where you've got sound waves that won't go through, but yet light does. What's your take on how that relates to, you know, kind of this apparent multi-dimensional angle? Because how else could light go through the vacuum of space? The fabric of space or the ether of space? I'm a chemist.
Yeah, okay, right. So how does light get through vacuum if there's, all the other waves we know, water waves live in water, sound waves live in air. They used to think light waves lived in ether, but now we seem to have gotten rid of the ether. So where do they live? And gravitational waves, let's throw that in the mix. So gravitational waves is a better answer, is that they live in space-time itself as something that can have energy and stress and can carry a wave. If you're happy with that, then once you have the space-time there, you can have these fields in space-time. You can have electric and magnetic fields. And so the answer I will give you, although I might give you a different answer if I think about this longer, is that they are in something. And there's not, just because it's a vacuum doesn't mean there's no space-time there. And there is space-time there, and that's where the fields are. okay, well. We'll come back to that if we have time. Oh, in the back here.
you're the physicist, I'm the engineer. There are amazing structural similarities about in the diagrams and the old wave particle two-slit thing.
Yes.
Where we went through the same things of it communicates somehow between these two. We had very analogous problems, which we now don't have. Is there anything similar going on?
Okay, so you're referring to the double slit experiment where you send a single particle, seemingly, through a pair of slits, and it still comes out the other side as one particle, but if you do it many times, it builds up an interference pattern as if it has gone through both slits. But then when you look to see, did it go through both slits, and do a different measurement, a different choice of measurement, you always say, no, it always goes through one slit. And you indicated that we've resolved this. Richard Feynman did not think it was resolved. He said this is the deepest mystery of quantum mechanics. He did not think it was resolved. I don't think it's resolved. There are better accounts of what might be going on in that case than there are in the case I talked about, entanglement. You can come up with these, do a Google for bouncing droplet experiments. You can come up with a nice physical analogy of how this might be happening. Basically, a particle bouncing on a bath of liquid makes a wave that goes through both slits, but the particle only goes through one and interferes with its own wave and leads to the same sort of thing. So there are reasonable explanations, maybe, of how this is going. There also are retrocausal explanations. Basically, what's happening here is it's either going through two slits or one slit. When you look one way, it seems like it went through two. When you look another way in the future, it looks like it really, oh no, it went through one. And if you solve it all at once and that future constraint of how you're going to look at it is part of the problem, then when you're going to look at it one way, maybe it really does always go through one slit. When you look at it another way, maybe it really does always go through two. So there are many ways to deal with that. But there are very much fewer ways to deal with entanglement, which is why many people these days are focused on entanglement and no longer the double slit experiment. This is more restrictive sort of model you can build. Right here, yes.
Going back to your talk, to your slide about time symmetry,
mm-hmm.
What do you think the recent discovery of time crystals
has to do with that? So time crystals has been in the news lately. They are kind of four-dimensional crystals, I would say. They are things that repeat themselves not only in space, but also in time. And yes, on a four-dimensional, one of my block universe diagrams, you can imagine a crystal there where the pattern extends both directions. And that is symmetric, certainly. And it obeys symmetric rules to go. You go forward and backward. I'd say it's just, I would say yet more evidence of time symmetry is what I would say a time crystal is. And maybe I'll leave it at that. So any more questions from my left here? How about right here?
So one of the things that's always discussed with regard to the entanglement is, you see it in every article, they'll always end with, and this doesn't mean that we can produce communication instantaneously at a distance. Can you explain why? Because it still seems like it's an engineering problem that if you just scaled it, you would in fact be able to develop a device that through entanglement can put an input here, and through entanglement the output at some distance.
So why? I mean, there are some uses of entanglement. I don't want to give the impression there are no uses. There are cryptographic uses that already exist. There are eavesdropping proof protocols. There are is possibility of doubling the information transfer you can send on a given channel using entanglement and other interesting things. But remember, when you just look at the bare outcomes, independent of the other side, and this for this case anyway, it's a 50-50 chance every time, no matter what Bob does. Actually, no matter what Alice does. There's no signal in here. It's just random noise. Nothing seems weird until they get back together and see how their outcomes are correlated. And strangely, there is no possibility, if quantum mechanics is right, there is no possibility of using any entanglement thing for a signal. There are these no-go theorems that prove that if quantum mechanics is right, you can't use this kind of thing to signal from Alice to Bob. Now, why is that? That's a very good question. And people are still puzzling this out. What is it about what's happening here that is preventing a signal? And I see it as an argument against faster than light influence or any spooky action at a distance. Every channel we know where you can send something from A to B, you can send information, you can send a signal, right? So if there is something flying between them, the fact that you can't send a signal is really weird. This is a fine-tuning problem. Why can't you see the signal? I have another problem, a fine-tuning question, in a retrocausal account, which is why we can't signal to the past. So if there's retrocausality going on in the world, why can't we use this to signal the past as well? And there are various, I could talk about this for hours, but basically, I think what it comes down to is symmetry. I think it comes down to the fact that the more symmetries there are in a problem, the more possibility it is to have an influence that gets washed out due to some perfect symmetry. And we know time symmetry is a good symmetry, and that symmetry might wash out the signal to the past. Oh, we're running out of time here. Okay, yes. That's an interesting point. So sometimes, is there ever a possibility where there's an initial condition and a final condition, and there are no solutions in the middle? One example of this is a light wave has to kind of fit in a laser cavity by half integer number of wavelengths. If the cavity is a little bit off, it doesn't fit. And you can do these cool experiments where you put an atom in a cavity, and the cavity doesn't fit the natural frequency that this atom wants to decay at. It wants to decay at some particular wavelength. But that wavelength doesn't fit in the cavity. And so there is no solution. Guess what happens? The atom doesn't decay. You could have this excited atom that would normally decay in vacuum. You put it in this cavity, it stops decaying. This is called frustrated spontaneous emission. And that's exactly what you said. There's no solution, so it doesn't happen. And then the probability is zero that it happens, and then you don't see it. And so, yes, absolutely. When you have a system where there's no solution, that you don't see it, something happen. Let's do one more over here, please.
I was wondering, as you were answering the question about how light travels through a vacuum, I was wondering if the quest for medium doesn't lead to an infinite regress. Because if the answer is it's the ether, then I would ask, well, what is the ether containment?
And then
exact containment. So is there
Well, but I think his point is the ether doesn't have to be a wave. The wave usually needs a medium to be in. Like water wave needs water, right? Sound wave needs sound. So if there were ether waves, well, and kind of there are space-time waves, there are gravitational waves. So that's not an ether, but it's something that gives us evidence that there is something where space-time is. It's not nothing just because there's nothing there.
It's sort of also kind of like Bohr's, is it really, you know, is it Schrodinger, is it really an isolated system? It may not be because it's the fabric of space and time.
Maybe we have to solve the universe all at once.
Right.
Yes.
Right.
So, could you say that psychic communication is really that instantaneous communication that doesn't exist?
Not instantaneous. You're talking about... are you talking about
psychic?
Oh, psychic. Okay. So this is interesting. So now, let's say we have another magic trick, where we have two psychics come in the room, and they can read each other's minds. Okay, and we could do experiments. You know, if we had that, we could do experiments. We could look in the black boxes and be good skeptics about this, and we could see how fast the psychic signal goes, right? We could separate them and make measurements, right? How fast does the signal go? And we could do all sorts of neat experiments if presented with this phenomena. Unfortunately, as Randy and others keep finding, is that when you set up the careful scientific system to test psychic powers, the psychic powers always seem to disappear. So we have not yet tested the speed at which that could happen. But if we can get a reproducible system, we can do experiments on it. It's not magic anymore. It becomes science that we could test. It would not be outside of science to be able to test that.
But you have for no communication that does exist in no other form that we can measure.
If we can't measure it, I wouldn't say it existed. If we can measure it, we can do science on it. Okay, this is very important. When I'm saying all at once, I'm not talking about now. I'm not talking about all at once like a now. I'm talking about the past, the future, the left, the right, all of existence all at once, not all of now all at once, which is, I guess, an important distinction. Okay, one last question, let's end here. We started with you, we can end with you as well.
If future states affect present events, what are the implications on free will?
Free will. Free from what? What do you want your will to be? What are the implications, if there is retrocausality in the world, on free will? The question is, what is the implication of retrocausal account on free will? If you could send a message to the past, it would have a great impact on what you would consider to be free will. But since without being able to send a message to the past, I don't see any indication. In fact, arguably, this saves free will in a certain sense, is that there's a third account I didn't even mention, where Alice doesn't have a free choice. Remember I said there are three assumptions, where there's action at a distance, there's retrocausality, or Alice doesn't have a free choice. Well, why not? Why doesn't Alice have a free choice? Well, she has a childhood that primed her, predisposed her, that at that moment in her life she was going to choose B. And Bob also has a childhood that at this moment in his life predisposed him to choose D. And it really wasn't free, and that's a third explanation, that really these aren't free settings at all, and they're correlated by virtue of what happened a billion years ago. This is called super-determinism. And I said that we don't want to consider this because then we can't trust any experiment, right? If I can't trust a free setting because I'm predisposed to set something some way, then I don't have free will. So if we rule that out and say there's a better account of retrocausality, then we save Alice's free will. Alice's choice is coming from outside the system, constraining the system. It can be whatever she wants. And the system responds to it. So I would say that if it does anything, it helps free will. Okay. One last finger here. It's related.
The giant Lagrangian for the entire history of the universe.
Yeah.
Doesn't that presuppose that there is already made?
The future is out there. The future, your choice you make tomorrow is out there. It's in the future. You haven't made it yet. But the reason you make it is because of your thoughts and your decisions leading up to that decision. And that's part of the system too. And that's the best account of your choices is your logic. People that want free will sometimes say, I want to be free from everything, including my own decisions. But no, you don't want your choices to be random. You want your choices to be considered, right? And so you don't really want, if you really think, well, what do I want from free will? You don't want randomness. You want connection.
You solve the giant Lagrangian for the entire universe with that final outcome that's way beyond anything we can begin to conceive of. It seems like our little part of it right now is all solved already. It is predetermined.
If you step outside of time, then the whole universe is there all at once, and we're experiencing it one moment at a time. But it doesn't mean that there's no links between now and now and now and now. They're links. And so those links are your decisions and are your thoughts. And those links are still there, even outside of time. Yes. Okay. Thanks.